So I welcome you to this conversation. We start talking about the class, your experience, and student participation. Mm-hmm. So how did you go about planning this class?
So this is the first unit that we are discussing in this course, Teachers and Teaching. Yeah. And in this first unit, we talk about actually teaching itself. What kind of activity is it? Mm-hmm. Why we may want to think of it as a professional activity, which means we have to discuss both teaching itself and what is meant by professional. And the commitment is that we bring out the importance of teaching given the contextual realities of our own country. Right. And I really want the students to think about this in a very meaningful way. Right. And to also to draw from the literature which exists about teaching both in our country and elsewhere. So that was the main sort of way to, the main overall vision of the course.
Yeah.
And hearing from students and from, the society around us, these are questions that are discussed both within the classroom and outside the classroom.
Right.
So I encourage them to actually bring these conversations into the classroom. Yeah.
So we could hear some of them have got some teaching experience and some of them have not.
Yeah.
So what were some of the assumptions that you had in your mind about their own prerequisite knowledge when they came to the...
Some of the assumptions about, I would imagine that they have internalized some of the aspects from philosophy of education, like what is the purpose of education? And definitely I think, I don't expect them to answer like a layman, to get a job. And they have a much richer understanding.
Right.
Also, some understanding of sociology and educational psychology, those bases that
and also
have.
Some exposure to the classrooms.
Definitely.
Yeah.
That, because I've been working in this institution, I do know that they get a lot of exposure. I want them to connect those to what we are discussing. About personal journeys, I ask, some of them have come to me both in connection with their internship proposal as well as they get
otherwise
interested, they come and talk, they share out of class, and I always try to bring those. You might have noticed in today's class also, specifically I mention names of students and what they have been sharing with me about some experience that has been either bothering them or excited them, maybe. Yeah.
So some of these experiences have been enriching the classroom conversations.
Yes.
Their experience of being in the classroom.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts about their participation in the classroom itself?
Yeah. For me, that is my style of teaching. If I don't hear from them, I don't know what is going on in their heads. Mm. And this connection between what I am saying, or not necessarily me, what some of the literature is saying, my own understanding, their experience.
Mm.
This class I didn't do it, but sometimes I'll bring in my own experience as a teacher, as a teacher trainer, and to highlight some issue. It will not be just a description, but to take the analysis in some direction to give a real example.
Right.
So I feel that is what they also value in the class.
So apart from using their prior experiences, teacher education programs are also supposed to be examine some of their own beliefs about teaching teacher.
Yeah.
Could you share some thoughts on how would you do that in the classroom?
Say
for example, in today's class they talked so much about teaching as a profession and some of the characterization of teaching. In some way they were related to their own beliefs of what teaching is and...
I think right from the day one I do this, but not in a very direct way. So, last class one of them said it has really shifted her idea about teaching. I don't recall right now what was the specific instance. I don't think she was one of the students who interviewed. But she herself said that, something today changed after last class's discussion. And I know some beliefs they share, some are their own beliefs, some come from, the general way we talk about education in society, right, about teachers.
Correct.
And so I have an agenda.
Right.
I have an agenda, and I tell them also upfront that, you know,
right,
for me teaching is a important and complex
right,
sort of occupation,
right,
and it should be taken with seriousness.
Correct.
Yeah. And
In today's class, you used a lot of resources for your lesson, be it some reading that you had given in
mm-hmm.
advance, be it the presentation.
Yeah.
Could you share your uh-huh. thoughts on that?
Okay. So, when we were discussing about teacher professionalism or the teaching as
a
professional
profession.
Activity, one reading that they had to do was reading by Socket. It's
Socket.
From
you,
a book.
You referred
yeah.
to
yeah.
that.
That is there as
yes.
a core reading in the course. And so I had given it to them actually the last week itself.
Right.
And in the course of time, I found that actually preparing them, giving them a sort of glimpse of what are the issues we'll take up and then giving the reading works.
Right.
So we had set the ground, you know, by these discussions
right.
on so on. I also tend to repeat certain things because, as you notice, not all of them are very familiar with English.
Mm.
So I draw attention to the specific, like professionalism, professionalization. Otherwise, to a non, you know, somebody who's not totally familiar with English, it looks, sounds the same.
Correct.
So this reading was given ahead
mm.
and then by in another discussion, I had a discussion with one of our colleagues
mm.
who had done the case study.
Oh.
So in the last class, I had actually invited her to present the
case study.
And as it happened, for her theoretical framework, she had used this Shulman's categories. And so I shared the PowerPoint with the class.
Right.
And although that particular reading of Shulman was not part of the core reading for this course, I asked them to look at the PPT
mm-hmm.
and those who are interested, I shared her case study
right.
also.
Oh, nice.
So that was also given to some students,
right.
but I said, please go through the...
Because that came in as part of the
PowerPoint.
Conversation
yeah,
many
because
times. Yeah,
she had already referred to it,
yes.
both when she presented the case
Correct.
Study and the idea of drawing
yeah.
the knowledge of the teacher, the knowledge
yeah.
base of the teacher.
True.
Then I prepared today's yep. presentation using both Socket and Shulman. So to create the link in a sort of logical way.
Okay.
That was what I had done the PPT.
Yeah.
And keeping it just, because both are fairly longish readings
right.
and I wanted them to get the...
Right. Coming to the classroom activities themselves, you engage them in lot of
mm.
questions, you ask them some questions and then you entertain a lot of questions from them.
Mm.
After that, you had a group activity.
Mm.
So how do you plan for this as a part of the lesson and how do you really execute them?
Mm. So, like I said, I'll just close about the reading.
Right.
Yeah, over the years, this is what I found,
mm.
that if I make a lesson plan on the assumption that they would have read,
right.
I lose many students in the class. Lose
Correct.
As in,
yeah.
I feel they are not following.
Right.
And for me, it's important that they get the ideas,
Correct.
Even if they are, they may or may not do the reading.
Correct.
I'm encouraging them and I will actually do exercise where, you know, they can connect their experience to the reading.
Mm.
Over years, I found I need to structure
right.
it.
Mm.
I'm still working on that aspect. So in the process of getting them involved, I like to have encouraged conversation and questions, even if it is a little bit, you know, I can manage that. If
right.
they go off track,
right.
I seem
yeah.
to be able to. Also, I found that group work allows the quieter students to actually participate.
Mm.
That's why I notice in the groups.
Mm.
And I find that in the group they are saying, even though to the whole class they may not talk
mm.
and they themselves have said they like group work.
Yeah.
But I don't always do group work. Last
yeah.
time I had called them to be on a panel,
mm.
like expertise. So yeah. I make it fun. Right?
Right.
I said it's like a television show.
Correct.
And I always want to be Barkadatta.
Yeah.
So you be on the panel. So they like that.
Yeah.
And last time I called two of them who confessed they hadn't read. I said, never mind, you be on the panel. And one of them actually later said, thanked me for it, said that, you know, it really made me connect to what we are saying. Especially this is a fairly big class,
about, yeah.
More than 50.
50 students.
So it's not possible to individually ask them to respond.
Right.
So in a group,
right.
Yeah.
The
There's
other
also
thing
some
that
evidence actually that group work is a good strategy for some classes.
The other thing that I liked is that students interact among themselves. Mm. Not only they ask question to you, but there were cross-group conversations.
Yes. Yeah.
So is it part of the classroom culture?
I think it's a good thing because that is what I want, right?
Right.
That they keep thinking about these issues.
Right.
And so if they are interacting in the class, I actually am very happy.
Right.
And I have some evidence that they continue this afterwards also.
Right.
Even if they're from different groups, they will have some arguments with each other.
Right. So because I noticed when... So how do you take these conversations forward in the course?
So one is the... I mean, the points about teaching, I too follow them, model them as well, right? So one is to reflect. And like today's class, because they had shared some of these things, I can get a sense of what is working in their minds.
Mm.
So I will try to draw it in my discussion points, you know, and also make them connect this. So also sometimes I might actually shift what I was planning to do in a class based on the classroom discussion,
right.
Or suggest another reading.
Hmm.
So small changes in the overall course,
right.
In my planning will happen,
right.
Based on what is being discussed and it's relevant to the overall course.
Hmm.
It will not, I won't go completely off.
Do you also miss out covering some of the things that you wanted today, but probably you would pass it on for next class?
Yeah, like I said, I would have actually liked at least 20-25 minutes for the discussion.
The last discussion,
yeah.
That they were
so engaged. There will be a spillover.
Right.
I have
correct.
Told them that we will continue the group discussion. They were very keen actually.
Yeah.
They had many questions.
I know.
Right? And luckily, I think my next class is tomorrow. So
right.
We will
so,
continue this.
So you would
yeah.
Naturally.
But it's a call one has to take. How much, you know, to stay with one,
right.
But in this course I think one can connect the dots.
Hmm.
Sometimes I don't worry too much if some things are left out.
Yeah.
If we have gone, you know, by going deep you also touch upon the key things. So
correct.
Yeah,
correct.
But it's always a balancing act between,
yeah,
yeah.
Right. So I think we have discussed many issues related to today's class, lot of insights from your own experience.
Hmm.
Thank you so much for sharing them. Thank you very much for being with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Last class, we were discussing on various aspects of whether teaching can be considered as a profession and what makes us think about teaching as a profession. Would we want to think of teaching as a profession? And some of the key ideas that we thought about, could you just recall about what is a profession and how, why we may like to think that teaching is a profession? Anybody would like to recall? You could think about what are the characteristics of a profession, number one. And why we might want to think that teaching shares some of those characteristics. Anything that you recall from last class? Yeah, I see a hand.
Okay. मेरे thinking है कि मतलब teacher वो होता है जो मतलब कुछ change लाना चाहता है मतलब society में जैसे कि need होती है.
Okay. Okay.
तो
just keep your answers brief because if I go off in one direction, we won't get. Yeah, so okay, teacher is a change maker, but that is too general, right? I mean, that is too general. So we want to bring it more into what is it that teachers do, which might make us think of them as professionals. I agree, teachers are change makers. They have a role in society. Anybody else? Yeah.
Expertise is one aspect we thought
right.
about.
That's right. Expertise or expert knowledge that we call. So I'm going to write that down because that's what we will also explore a little more. Right, someone else.
Pedagogical knowledge.
Yes, so part of this knowledge is pedagogical knowledge, that's right.
Goal orientation.
Goal orientation, that's right. We did speak in the past that professionals have a goal orientation. Right, excellent.
Skillful action.
Skillful action, that's yeah. right. Expertise has knowledge and it has skills, right? Right. Any, maybe I can take a few more. Okay.
So, we talked about understanding of the situation okay. and responding upon it. So, right. Under that we had 2 points. Reflection in action, that is on the spot. And the second one is reflection on action. So, after the action has happened.
Correct. So, I'm going to capture both of that in this point. Reflection or... reflective practice, right? Who had a hand up? Someone here. Yeah.
Yes, it is reflection based and it is the also a complex work to work on it. So I think it is goal orientation and the complex.
Complexity, that's
yeah, complexity.
Right. That's right. So somewhere we also think that professional or something deserves to be called a profession if it is quite complex and you need a it's not general knowledge, you need specific expertise. You are an expert in something, you can't be an expert in everything. So professionalism, the notion of a profession carries this understanding of expertise as well, yes.
Professionals have commitment to their work and
commitment. Yes.
Status. Yeah. They have to maintain status of their work.
All right. So you said commitment. I'm going to put that. Okay. And you also said status. So I'm going to put it here.
Yeah. It's not much relevant to the teacher profession because status is mostly related to the. Higher salary and
true
economically
yeah well, yeah maybe we'll discuss that aspect a little more but not a whole deal today. We are really going to focus on this aspect but we'll see. Professionalism or professions do have status associated with it and that's when we wonder whether teaching can be called a profession because there isn't very much status associated with teaching, right? That's something we did discuss. We might want to think a little more about it. Yes.
One more thing that we discussed, which I think is sort of related to commitment, was accountability as a profession.
Right.
Professional.
Right. I'm not sure where I'm going to put it, but. One last answer, somebody wanted to say something? All right, so now this, why do you think accountability can be in two buckets? Why am I putting things in two different sort of columns? I put a whole lot of things here and I put status and maybe accountability here and that is an important distinction maybe. A useful distinction, I don't know important, but I think it's a useful distinction for us to make between what is called as professionalism and professionalization. That's something that I think it's interesting to make. And one of the arguments we may say that whether someone is a member of a profession or not, we can still describe the work that they do, their practice as professional. To give you an example, if someone at home cooks a dish exceptionally well, right? You say, wow, that's professional. Or you bake a cake for your daughter's birthday. You're not a professional baker. And then someone says, wow, that's professional, as if it came from the bakery, right? So that idea of professional, right, being very good at your work, being an expert at your work, regardless of whether you get paid for it or not, is what we might like to think about as professionalism. Is that clear, Vishal? So status is something that is coming from the external side, right? I'm not saying the two are not linked with each other, and maybe we'll have a little bit time to talk about, but regardless of whether something has a high status and all the things associated with it, you can still talk of the action or the practice as being very professional, right? Somebody you know might be growing flowers really, really well, right? The roses in their garden look like ready to be on an exhibition. Again, you say that's professional, even though they are not doing it. It's a hobby. It's not a profession the way they might have a real profession of being a doctor or an engineer or whatever. But you still can call that work that they do as professional. Do you get the distinction? And why is it important, do you think? Why is it important in the context of teaching to talk of making this distinction between professionalization, we'll talk a little more, and professionalism? Why is it? Why should we bother about making this difference between the two words? It comes. That's one word. Professionalism. I don't know whether versus, it's not against, but it's like two different ideas connected with teaching as a profession. So why is it important to make this difference? All right.
Ma'am, when I'm talking about this, at least a job, when we are taking, each job has its own dignity when taking in the aspect of a society. Like, okay. If we are taking, for example, doctor as a profession, I think when making it in the status of profession is giving him or her some sort of dignity in the society. So that may be, so when comparing to the teachers also, same things, to make it as a profession may give them a dignity which indirectly give them a confidence.
Okay, so you used a new word. Now, we've said, okay, if I say this is the professionalism set, where would you put dignity? I'm asking, Anne, where would you put? Would you put it here or would it put it here?
I will put it there in status.
That's right. So, dignity is an aspect of professionalization. But why should we bother making this distinction is the question.
When I was reading the reading, yeah. What I could draw out of it is that this particular professionalism, you know, the set is more about what goes behind the, you know, what happens as a teacher, what does teacher feel and do and work. But the professionalization part is more about how does outsiders see that person. How does that profession as a whole is seen by the society?
Okay.
Adding to all of that is something based on our discussion in the last class also of professionalism versus professionalization was professionalism becomes an adjective, as in like, I mean, a way to work, like, you know, defining a style of working. Mm. Whereas professionalization then becomes like a profession is a noun, right? So, I mean, it's like, defining teachers, and then at one point we touched upon the idea of whether teachers can be, if teachers could be bracketed into like professionals, or if it was more than just a profession as a role of a teacher. So in that sense, I found the distinction between the
two. So I want to just sort of suggest, and there's a reading which I haven't yet introduced to you, but very often in our conversations, not in the class conversations, but in conversations with people, people think that, you know, the ideas or some of the things associated with being a professional are somewhat negative. One key idea is being money-minded, right? That, you know, so, and that is something a bit negative which is often associated with a profession or professional, right? So if some, and teachers have got a bad name because of teachers' unions, which seem to, you know, always argue for more and more salary. And I think I was discussing with, Vishal was sharing with me and Chetana were sharing with me off the class, not in the class, about situations which we have all heard of in the remote villages where the government teacher is getting a very good salary but is not really displaying professionalism in their work. Maybe they are not giving as much attention to the teaching work. There could be other reasons, like in Vishal's case, you were saying that the principal had many work and so you got employed, through some, not directly by the principal, but the department agreed that. But yet, and some others were sharing with me, I forget, but in your practicum and in your field immersions, you might have come across where, despite the high salary, there is, they are not, can you say they are being professional in this sense? Exactly, exactly. So that is why it is important, and what happens, so that's the connection. If many members of a group of, let us call it profession, if many members of a profession don't do their work professionally, are not displaying professionalism, then society begins to distrust professionals. And that happens in many fields. We all know, you know, we sometimes think lawyers are not great because they're not, you know, actually doing their work. They're only after some monetary gain, or doctors who are not doing their work well. And then we say that, you know, so the entire profession gets a bad name, right? And therefore, it is kind of, there is a relation. If we work on professionalism, then the profession can get the dignity. Dignity cannot come only by demanding, right? Some of you might have seen this quote, which is often there in auto rickshaws: give respect and take respect. Have you seen that? Yeah? Meaning that you display the kind of action and then you can get the respect. So just demanding respect but not doing. Just yesterday somebody, not yesterday, on Saturday, one of the students who is working in a remote area in Rajasthan was sharing, I mean, it's very upsetting that the teacher who gets a very good salary is not coming to school, or when they are coming at the training meetings, they are not even listening to each other, right? So how can you demand status and respect from others when you are not giving it to yourself? And believe you me, that I think all of us get satisfaction more from the way we do our work than from the money we get paid for it. I'm not saying money is not important. I'm not saying professionalization is a bad word, but I think it something is deeper than that. Yeah, somebody had a hand. Yeah.
Ma'am, I don't know whether it is right to say at this moment. So is it right to say that when taking teacher as a profession, should we made it as contextual, like according to the situation or the environment? Because like when taking the teacher in an urban area and the rural area, it's entirely different, because in the rural area, they might not get the dignity, the status, they might not get the reflective practice, might not be going on there. So should we take teacher as a professional as contextual? I don't know whether
So that is why I'll sort of sum up this and we'll move forward. It is, my argument is, let us focus on teacher professionalism. When we talk of teacher professional development, let us focus on developing their expertise, their commitment, their reflective practice and aspects of that, rather than focus on do they get a good salary, what is the respect we get. Just one small point, in my experience, it's the rural teacher who gets a lot more respect than the urban teacher. Right? In the rural areas, a teacher is still a respected figure, despite everything, despite all the negatives of not being professional. In the rural areas, they are still respected for multiple reasons, right? So, but I am saying, can responding to context is okay, but doing your work professionally, or in simple language, doing your work well should not be contextual. You should do your work well because, I'll use a term from our culture, right? Because it's your dharma, right? So for me, teaching is a dharma that you do. You do your work well because that is your dharma, not because you're paid for it. That is what you do. And to me, that is, it's not exactly the idea of professionalism, but when there is so much talk of salary, status, work conditions, blah, 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 and all that, I think it is important to focus on professionalism, and maybe professionalization will follow or will be more accepted rather than go from this side. Of course, I'm saying the two interact. They are not totally independent of each other, right? So if members of a certain occupation do their work with a lot of genuineness, interest, expertise, people will value, right? But sadly, in teaching, we all know that even the B.Ed. Colleges themselves don't take the education of teachers as very, very important, right? It is done as because it is needed. That is professionalization, right? You are saying if you have a degree, only then you can teach. But the degree has to mean something. The certification has to mean something. And that is something which, as students of education, we have to think about. We have to recover this idea of what it means to be a, to work professionally, or if you like, to do your dharma, whether someone is watching or not. That, yeah.
Ma'am, but in that case, I mean, we know a lot of, there are enough and more experiences in this room of meeting teachers who have walked in with a lot of motivation, a lot of professionalism.
Correct.
And have eventually lost it along the way.
Right.
Because they don't see it as necessary anymore, because the system doesn't allow them to survive if they are in that sort of mode of teaching or whatever. So, I mean, I can see it as like you need one for the other and the other for the one.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you, the argument usually is you start from here and then you come here, but you're saying the other way around.
Yeah. Yeah.
But examples are that this way doesn't work, so.
I'm not sure if it doesn't work. What I will say is commitment alone is not necessary. It's not enough. It's necessary. So, just now in my... when I use the example of dharma, I might have sort of stressed commitment and motivation indirectly. But to be a professional, commitment alone is not enough. Let me go to the simple example of growing the roses, right? You might be so committed to growing the rose, you overwater it and you kill the plant, right? And then that will demotivate you. So in a sense, you need commitment, but you also need expertise. You also need to understand the complexity of what it means. Growing a rose is really much simpler than doing the work of teaching. So partly why demotivation happens is there. And again, I think I was sharing the example, right, of that amazing teacher in Haryana who, despite everything, was in some ways going, you know, well beyond what can be expected. And on the other hand, we have teachers who are not even doing the minimum of what is expected. So there is a problem. We have to accept there is a problem. Keep that question, whether it is external or internal, whether professionalism can influence professionalization or vice versa. I'm not ready to say it one way or the other. I'm just opening up the question for us to think about. All right.
Yeah, ma'am. So my personal experience, I want to say in short. तो सेकंड सेमेस्टर मैंने आईटीआर किया था तो मेरा टॉपिक था एसएमसी हाउ डज एसएमसी वर्क्स इन बाड़मेर डिस्ट्रिक्ट तो वहाँ पर 10 स्कूलों में मैंने विजिट किया तो वहाँ पर दोनों तरह की स्कूल मिली जहाँ पर मतलब टीचर अच्छे काम भी कर रहे हैं और दूसरी जगह जहाँ टीचर काम नहीं कर रहे हैं तो उसके पीछे रीज़न है मतलब सोसाइटी सपोर्ट करती है और सोसाइटी मतलब मोटिवेट करती है टीचर को उनको रेस्पेक्ट देती है तो टीचर अच्छा काम करता है और टीचर कोऑर्डिनेशन ये भी एक फैक्टर है मतलब अच्छा काम करने का स्कूल में, तो ये मैंने मैंने देखा. अब ज्यादा ज्यादा क्या कहें.
हाँ, थैंक यू. सो इट्स इंटरेस्टिंग व्हाट ही इज सेइंग इज दैट व्हेन अ टीचर डज गुड वर्क ही हैज इन हिज एक्सपीरियंस इन एसएमसी, इन एसएमसी आर यू नो ऑल ऑफ यू राइट, स्कूल मॉनिटरिंग कमिटीज, वेयर he found both types of schools where teachers are doing good work and where teachers are not doing good work. His understanding is when the society is supporting the teacher does good work. Now, I want you to listen specifically to that. A, in this course, we want to understand what is the meaning of teacher doing good work, right? It is not common sense. That's number one, right? When, what do we understand when we say teachers mean good work? The second question we want to ask is how do we enable, empower, give knowledge to teachers so that they do good work? That is the question before us, right? It is true, nobody works in an isolation. That is why professionalization is also important. Professional community is also important, right? My, and that is in a way similar to what Vani was saying, right? Whether the teacher gets demotivated. Is it too much to ask that the teacher does her work in such a way that the society acknowledges and is willing to give that teacher the support? Is it too much to ask? I'm not sure. Let's just keep that question, right? In Teach for India and others, that would be called as teacher leaders, right? Can you be a teacher leader rather than waiting for support? Can you do your work in such a way that you can get the support? That is being a really high level of professionalism. All right, let's look at some points and let's move further. Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to know how you understand dharma, whether it is the duty concept of the teacher that she should be professional.
Yeah.
And also, what about the influence of culture, the kind of where the teacher is situated?
Absolutely.
How much that has influence on the teacher's professionalism?
Yeah.
Because when we talk about India, we're talking about different kinds of teachers and the level of what is there a particular standard of professionalism that we're expecting? So that's
true,
what I'm trying to think.
See, the word dharma is complex. I don't think it has a easy translation in English. Yeah, I think duty is part of it. There is definitely duty is one aspect of it. Did you want to say something in that aspect? No. But it's more than just doing your duty, right? There is a deeper understanding about dharma that is involved. It's interesting that the word duty, like the word profession, has got a negative connotation in our country. That's why maybe it's better for us to recover from our culture. You also mentioned culture, the word dharma, which somehow does not have this negative connotation. It could have negative connotation if you associate it with some kind of religious fundamentalism. So there are problems in these words. But I think doing one's duty, not because someone is looking down at you, or you are only doing it if you think someone is, inspecting. That is why where duty comes as a negative word, right? But if it is something which is coming from inside, which is intrinsic, then I think it's something that can take us forward. And that is a question that I request all of you to keep in mind. What is it that, you know, we can make or create this culture of professionalism, if you like, or doing your teaching dharma well, if you like, right? That's some question that we remain.
I think, can we distinguish between duty and responsibilities? Because by my opinion, duty is that which is given by us from someone. That's particular work we have to do by taking salary. And responsibility can be intrinsic, that I have to do that. As we learned in last class, that was the example. One teacher came from that engineering background and started teaching in the school.
Right.
And after that, she thought that it's not getting money or doing duty for that hour. She realized that she is not teaching. She have to improve in herself that professional skills, and so she went to the training for better teaching in future.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think dharma is related to the responsibility rather than saying it's duty for us, maybe.
Interesting. I think that's a good way to think about it. He's saying that let's not look it at duty in our context. The word duty has this negative idea, but let's look at it as responsibility. Yeah, words carry meaning. Like for example, in one of the readings earlier, we distinguished between the word pedagogue and didact. But in the English word, it's pedagogue that is used loosely to involve didactic, or and the word didact has a negative connotation in many of our readings. So yeah, maybe responsibility is a better word rather than duty, and better fits with the idea of dharma. Thanks for that. Let's go just over this, and then we'll have time to discuss in groups. So I just consolidate some of the thoughts and take you a little further. And I'm glad you brought up that case study, because cases give us something to think about. Yeah, sure. Because this teacher, even though she knew enough mathematics, when it came to teaching class 2 children, she said she needed some kind of teaching. That's where this idea of teacher expertise comes in, right? So what is this expertise that a teacher has is something that we might want to explore. We will explore today. All right, so this is just quickly the distinction that we've been talking about. Professionalism is about practice. The quality of work, expertise, depth of knowledge, skill in action, all of it has come already. Reflective practice, ideal of service, moral standards, right? That's how we can associate with professionalism. The word duty doesn't come, you might say, in the moral standards or in the ideal of service responsibility. And we know that the first thing people will say, teaching is a noble profession. That's an ideal of service, right? How to live up to that rather than just give lip service to it? That's our question, really. Yeah. And professionalization is, like Anne said, value in society. What is the salary that you get? Annual leave. You know, the kind of work conditions. Do you get job benefits? Do you have entitlement to study leave? Because any profession, the way it is understood, means that you keep developing. It is not that you finished your MBBS or you finished your law degree and you're done with it. As you practice, you keep finding new problems, right? Of course, we all know that not every member of a profession goes up, but the whole profession is improved when a few people keep going forward, keep trying to solve new problems in new contexts, right? So that is where a profession as a group, not as an individual, gets its dignity. When the profession keeps trying to solve society's problems more and more, right? And that's the study leave part, regulation. So regulation typically in a full-fledged profession happens within the profession. It's not that you and I, we don't democratically decide what doctors should do, right? What the work of a doctor is not decided democratically by society. It is decided by the experts within the profession. That is where the expertise comes, right? Within the profession itself, they will decide what is the best way for treatment, etc., etc. So that is regulation internal. I did not put that. And this thing, so here I said moral standards, because moral, again connected to the word dharma in some ways, is an internal compass of telling you what is good and bad. I think it's easy when most teachers do know when they are being unfair to a child or partial, they do know that it is doing something wrong. That's a moral standard, which is internal compass that we have. Ethical standards or ethical norms is the norms of the profession, right? What you should do, what's the kind of class organization. In teaching, all it's a bit weak. In medicine, for example, doctors take an oath, right? Last semester we discussed whether teachers should have an oath. Maybe we can take it up as we go. Yeah.
Ma'am, again, I'm getting confused about two things, like the expertise and the depth of the knowledge, because like we previous week, we were discussing about a job opportunity where they are mentioning they doesn't want, it's not necessary that we want the BA degree, but the patients to look after the primary level kids. So is it the, like, is it because like whether we are not having a code of ethics or something that is not universal for the teachers, again, is giving a negative connotation in terms of this expertise?
No, I don't think expertise is negative, but it is true that teachers to themselves as a community have led to this kind of lack of respect from society. Somebody shared, I think in our class, the advertisement, right, where they were looking what for ability to speak English, and will you say that? Yeah.
Patients to look after the primary kids.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I think what was in the mail was that ability to handle the children with patient,
yeah.
And there was no professional degree required. It was mentioned that there's no BA required,
yeah.
And good English speaking,
yeah.
Skills.
Yeah.
These were the, yeah. Things mentioned in a job description.
Correct.
For the primary,
yeah.
Grade,
yeah.
Students.
Yeah. So I'm glad you asked this question. So here is a job offer where they're looking for patience, good English, and ability to handle primary children, right? And no BA degree. Now, what does this say? Do you agree, first of all? Do you agree that patience, good English, and ability to handle, whatever that means, huh? Ability to handle primary children is enough to be a good teacher? How many of you think that's enough? Nobody. Excellent. You've been thoroughly, like, I won't say indoctrinated, but you have been, yeah. But society thinks this. Why? And that's where her confusion is. Now, why does society think it? Because teaching is not professionalized. And the reason why teaching is not professionalized is, as a community, we ourselves don't value the degree. We don't value the degree, number one. We, I don't mean you and I, but the ecosystem or the system doesn't value the degree to the extent that it should. It doesn't seem to matter if someone has a BA degree or not. And I'll go a little beyond, which might help you answer this question. So in the common public's mind, whether you have a BA degree or not, it doesn't seem to make a difference to the way you do your work, right? And but is this really true? I'll give you just one possible example, or two examples. One is a older study, which if you're interested, you write to me, I'll share with you, done in Andhra Pradesh, where they were studying teacher motivation, if you like, or teacher incentives, where what do you, you know, this question, how do you motivate teachers to teach in such a way? We don't want anything. We don't want that every child should become Abdul Kalam or thing. What should you do so that teachers do the minimum that is required for them, which is help children learn? And this is in elementary school, right? So can you make the job condition, incentive, inspection, all that? So they tried many variables, right? One interesting finding, I'm oversimplifying it for in the interest of time. One interesting finding is that any incentive worked. It's not necessarily money, which means that if teachers get some kind of attention and recognition, they are able to, there is a difference in the way they do their job. Second interesting finding, all of you should. Okay, before that, there is a pre-finding, which when they compared the outcome, learning outcomes of children under trained teachers and untrained teachers, no difference, which is what leading to that kind of ad, right? BA degree, not necessary, because whether you are taught by a degree wala teacher or a non-degree teacher, no difference in the groups of children. They are working mostly in rural, this is a rural focused study. But when they did the incentive study, A, they found that regardless of the type of incentive, there was a shift, right? Now comes the interesting part. But the actual improvement happened only in the case of trained teachers. Now, what does that tell you? Do you understand what's going on? Anybody who doesn't understand, ask. Because this is interesting to note. When they gave incentives, don't worry about the incentive. They tried money, they tried other things, they did a whole lot of different study. When incentive happened, improvement was found. But more or most improvement happened only in the case of trained teachers. What is going on here? Trained, who had the DL-Ed or the B-Ed? Teachers who had the teacher certification, B-L-Ed, I mean B-Ed or D-Ed. I think in that case it was DL-Ed, Diploma in Elementary Education, because it's an elementary school study. What's going on?
Yeah.
1 minute. Yeah.
I think that creates a room to believe that the trained teachers did get something valuable from their training.
Yeah.
But until the incentive was not applied, they were not actually applying those skills or that what they got from the training into the practice.
Yeah.
So it took that incentive for their training to really turn into something valuable that would result in a better practice.
Exactly.
So then we can't say it's ineffective.
Exactly. So this study, so the first time, I think one of the persons who did the study, Karthik Muralidharan from World Bank, the first part when he said, I said, oh my God, let's close all the B.Ed. colleges, right? Where it said that B.Ed. or non-B.Ed. results or trained or untrained, I shouldn't use B.Ed. Had no difference, but then he said, wait, and then he said, shared this part of the study, right? So, yeah, so there is evidence that incentive works for everybody, but there is expertise involved, right? Again, to go back to a simple metaphor, the incentive of seeing the plant bloom is there for all of us, right? But if you don't know what is the right manure, when do you have to water, when do you have to cut it, then you won't get the same effect. So expertise is required. But again, none of it alone is doing the work, right? None of it is alone doing the work. That is why the complexity comes in the work of teaching. I'll give you just another example, which was she did not observe classrooms or outcomes. This was last year, one of the students did a study, a survey of 50 teachers between trained and untrained teachers. There was a clear difference in many ideas among the trained teachers versus the untrained. Trained meaning those who have done the pre-service teacher education, either B.Ed. or Diploma, D.Ed. Right? These are the popular. Now it is called D.L.Ed., Diploma in Elementary Education. So two of these I will offer as evidence that training does make a difference. Right?
Ma'am, just one other point I think this study reveals that you just told us was that numbers cannot really lead us to find out what is happening. I mean, the numbers are not enough.
Numbers meaning?
So, for example, when you share that when they went by only learning outcomes under trained and untrained teachers, they didn't find a difference.
Correct.
But then when they went a little deeper and tried with this incentive scheme, they could see the difference.
Yes.
So, we really need to go beyond numbers, and many of these government surveys and monitoring mechanisms go only by learning outcomes.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that also tells us that it's not enough.
Exactly. And I'm very glad. So outcome, that is why you can't measure a teacher's performance only on the basis of the student's outcome. That's number one. And if you do that, that is partly a political move, right? It is a political move to deprofessionalize teaching, right? And I think If the aim of teaching is true education, we should all resist that. We should all resist that. Because the aim of education is not merely for someone to pass a reading test or pass the standardized test. The aims of education are, there are deeper aims of education which we have discussed. We won't discuss in this class, but you know that, right? So that is also another thing that we need to keep in mind and which will bring me to the next slide. I know some of you want to speak, but I just asking you to wait for the time being. Right, so this is a kind of what the socket reading I've just summarized, where for today's class, we won't go into the moral dimension or the dharma part of teaching. We will take it up. But today, our class is about expertise, right? So if you look and if you connect, this part is the pedagogue part, and this is the didact part, if you like. This is the character commitment, and this is the pedagogic knowledge and the subject knowledge. But socket makes, and that connects to that, the teacher's work is not limited to the classroom. the center thing. Of course, that is the central work where the teacher does the work. But her work is not limited to the classroom. In order for teacher or teaching to be professional, it has to go beyond the classroom. The first one here is collegiality, which I think one of you is studying, right? Collegiality means what? As a professional community, do you discuss the problems of your profession with each other? And that is which very rarely happens in a most of our traditional schools. And it's interesting. So teaching has been compared to, it's called cellular, meaning what? Once the door is shut, then it is, you know, totally like what I do is only between you and us, right? And so it's interesting that this class is being videotaped. In some ways, it breaks the cellularity of the work of teachers, right? But collegiality means that you discuss your work professionally with your colleagues. The word colleague comes from, the word collegiality comes from the word colleagues, right? We all know that teachers do this informally, right? In the staff room, you discuss the naughty boy or the problem boy or some other problem that has happened, you do discuss. But maybe not to the extent that you want professionals to discuss it. As a case, as something which we can problem solve together, as we can learn from each other, that is what. So in medicine, for example, case discussions and clinical discussions are very common, right? You will even see that the fourth year students are going behind the resident doctor and they go and they actually look at the patients and they must be discussing, right? Operations are visible, right? So when the doctors are all in teaching hospitals, the operation is actually studied by the next group of surgeons. So they will be discussing, right? Cases are also studied and discussed. We know, of course, there is a peculiar problem of teaching. One doctor, one patient, more or less. Or many doctors, one patient. That also happens when you have a team of doctors attending. In teaching, it's the reverse. Many students and one teacher, right? But that doesn't prevent us from professionally discussing, right? Understanding and building a deeper understanding of how to teach better. That's the collegiality aspect, which is connected to the collaborative leadership. If I know something better, do I share? Do I tell the principal? Do I become the principal? All those questions. Then there is community engagement. That is, you don't want the teacher to be a community leader, but how to get the support of the SMC? So you have to be aware of the community in many dimensions. And of course, this is a long-term goal. Do we also think of our work as not just helping you pass your 10th standard exam or your, you know, learning to add, but how am I also developing you as a citizen of this country? How is my work contributing to the country? Many teachers do not see their work in this dimension, right? Many teachers, and next unit, when we will soon go to the next unit, how does a teacher see their own role and identity? Teachers rarely see themselves as these, you know, people who are actually making a difference to society. That's a question that we will address in the next unit. But now for the next, I don't know, how many minutes do we have? 25. Oh, excellent. So for the next remaining time of the class, we will discuss this expertise part, which is connected with knowledge and the case that Vishal also mentioned and which Joita shared with you. She uses some 7 dimensions of knowledge, right, which is there on the next slide. And these dimensions were proposed by Lee S. Schulman. And again, I will share with you the paper. I have not a very good PDF, but the paper in which he discusses it, these 7 dimensions. But we'll look at that for now. And these are only the knowledge base, the argument that we can make when people say, what is so great in teaching, right? You know math, you know children, you go and teach. We already know that teacher Shruti is her fiction name, who found that was not enough, right? she needed some more understanding, which is why she enrolled for a teacher education program. She took a B.Ed. She resigned from her job, took 2 years off, or 1 year. Earlier B.Ed was 1 year and 9 months, yeah. Interesting, right? The same time it takes to produce a baby. yeah. But, and she did her, she got something, she definitely benefited from that training, but she wished the training had more. Because here is a reflective teacher who is thinking very actively about her job, and she's happy that now the B.Ed program is for 2 years, right? So that you could learn more, you get develop the expertise, and of course the value of experience is something which we will also refer to when, or you may go back to when you talk about how do we educate teachers the before we send them into the classroom. In real life, teachers don't always have the degree before they get into the classroom. Sometimes they get into the classroom and then do the degree. And many times, like Shruti, it is after they have the experience of the classroom that they value the degree more, right? Yeah. Because now we are able to connect it. Now the question, of course, which we can ask is, how can we make a teacher education program connect like this? You know, to some ways, what I think Teach for India also does. They build the connection very early. They base it on the experience, experiential learning, but that's not the topic for today. Yeah. So, yeah, I love this rainbow. Yeah, 7 rainbow, that's, you know, my sort of weakness. I don't know if you can read the top one. Maybe you can't. Yeah. Oh, thank you. Excellent. So, the first point, of course, is content knowledge, right? And maybe it's correct. I will spend just a bit expanding on all this. Maybe it is valid that a teacher education program assumes you got your content knowledge from your previous degree, from your plus two if you are training to be a elementary school teacher, from your college if you are training to be a secondary school teacher, B.Ed. Do you think this is a valid assumption? And the same assumption are made by other, you know, programs. I think Teach for India also says that content we will not focus on, rightly or wrongly. What's your opinion? I want to ask quickly.
So, if you look at teaching as a, if we're talking about expertise over here, and also in your in our list of things we looked at getting leave for study and all. So we're obviously looking at teaching as a continuous learning process.
Yeah.
I mean, as a value that teachers need to have. So then content knowledge comes as part of that.
Yeah.
Which is something that no one can be given all content knowledge at one time. It's a continuous learning process. As and when a problem arises, you think ahead of it and
Yeah. So in a way, it's a valid assumption. I will say that the current situation in our country is that sadly, even at the degree level, definitely very often at the school level, again, I should not generalize because there are excellent schools and excellent colleges, right? But very often, content is not taught very well. So people who enter the teaching program, yeah, B.Ed or D.Ed, D.L.Ed, do not already have a strong content, right? So I think the problem is cyclical. So not very well prepared teachers going into classrooms, doing their job, you know, the assumption that if they have good English and good classroom management skills, they will do their job well, leads to, I think, the problem where content is not taught strongly enough. So content knowledge has to be the base. You're teaching children, but you're teaching them something. So you better be an expert at that something first. And this may be more true for high school teachers. I think we had this discussion last time. How much of content is needed for an elementary school teacher? How much of depth of content knowledge is needed for high school? Maybe very strong content knowledge is maybe more required for the middle and higher grades rather than the elementary grades, if you can assume. But I still feel that, and many of our present teacher education program do focus, even if you don't need to know calculus to teach class 2, you need to know a little bit of what is the discipline of mathematics, right? Or what is, how is the discipline of science different from the discipline of history? Even if you are teaching, you know, third standard children, you need to understand a sense of the, you know, the way your, the nature of the subject, which is, I think, something all of you might be studying in your pedagogy courses now. I hope that is happening. You want to say something?
No.
Yeah. So the first is content knowledge. The second is what is called general pedagogical knowledge and skills, special reference to broad principles and strategies, like, you know, when you are, and this is often given importance in teacher development. Communicate well, speak slowly, and I sometimes don't listen, like don't talk with your back to the classroom, and so on, for, so forth. Plus general pedagogy, how do you structure a lesson, you know, start, end, finish, have a plan. All these are general skills. Did you learn some of that? Yes. Please do use a mic. Yeah.
As per my experience, means when I taught in third class standard students, I introduced that subject, like student know that subject, that content about, like we take example, mango. Means agar hum mango pe koi poem padha rahe bachchon ko, to usse pehle bachchon ko us mango ke baare mein kuch knowledge hai. Like to wo knowledge hume bahar nikalna hai, matlab kya kya knowledge hai unke baare mein. फिर बाद में हमें वो पोएम पढ़ानी है, मतलब बच्चों को ये, मतलब व्हाट वी से, मतलब बच्चों को, मतलब वो क्यूरियोसिटी रह जाती है कि मैंगो के बारे में अब तक हमने ये सीखा है, और उसके ऊपर अब पोएम भी है, ये क्यूरियोसिटी हमको पकड़ के रखनी है ताकि वो, मतलब ज़्यादा उसके बारे में नॉलेज ले सके.
So this point actually, it comes in this general pedagogical skills that you should know, and it also comes somewhere here, knowledge of learners and their characteristics. That learners, when they come to the class, so Vishal was saying that if you teach about a mango or a poem about a mango, then we have to keep in mind that the children already have some understanding about that, and also how to make them interested, which are, one is this bucket and one is this, how to teach well. But in content knowledge, we need to also know what, we need to know quite a bit about maybe mango if we are teaching it in a science class, but maybe about poetry, right? What is interesting in the poetry? What is it that we want the children to get from that poem? Yes, we do. So all these are connected, right? We do need to understand that, you know, when they come to school, they have already seen a mango, but we also need, why am I teaching them this poem? What is there in this poem? Is it a new words? Is it new vocabulary? Is it some other way that the poet has done? What is it that we want? So that is also required. And say if you are teaching Hindi or language literature, you need to have that content knowledge. You need to have an understanding of what, you may not tell it to the child, but you need to keep it in the back of the mind, right? And that is also connected with this, which is curriculum knowledge. Why is this poem there in that textbook? What is the objective of having that poem in the textbook? Maybe in very many times this is not explained at all, but as teachers, can we inquire, right? Can we be professional? Can we have this discussion? What is, why should this poem be there in this textbook? Then you can ask the question, which, you know, if the objective of keeping the poem is to help children teach rhymes, can I, knowing this part, right, this knowledge of educational ends and purposes is one, knowledge of learners. Now this poem is in a Hindi that my class doesn't understand. Can I bring in another poem? If the idea is to make them phonologically aware or get the sense of rhythm, if that is the objective, why can I not bring another poem? It's a question we can ask or not as a teacher. It's not that this poem is given by some god, right? You have to know the aims of education, why that poem and the curriculum in that class. And then we can be flexible in the way we do the work, right? So that is the point of expertise in teacher. And I think if teachers are strong, if tomorrow the inspector comes to the class and says, why didn't you teach this poem? We can argue back. I didn't teach this poem because. So another thinker in education, Fenstermarker, he says that a good teacher should give a reason and a justification. Now, and he makes a distinction. You can give a superficial reason. Yep, why did I teach this poem? Because you have to pass that exam or you have to complete the unit test. That is a superficial reason, right? But the deeper reason is what is the reason for teaching children poem? If you know that, then you can make an argument that is not achieved by this poem because my class has this set of speakers. Therefore, I use this poem. You want to test them on that skill, please test them. How brilliant that will be, right? Then teachers and inspectors both will stop complaining, I think. Yeah? So this is the world we have to imagine also sometimes. So that is with particular grasp of the material. So you should know, this is not an untrue situation, right? There are schools where if you go and ask the teacher to teach, they just pick up the textbook and start reading. They won't know even the name of the textbook. This is, what do you think? Professional, not professional. Obviously not professional, right? It's really, they've not even thought about it. They've not even thought about it, right? And then that will lead to someone arguing that why send children to school. I will not buy that argument. I think it is important that not only do they read the poem about the mango reading level, they appreciate the way the poet has written. They might get some, you might tell them, write two lines about another fruit in your surrounding. Kele ke upar, ya, so many fruits are there in our country. You can write. So they develop the ability, they become creative, they, you know, connected with many things. Why not? Why should that not happen? Isn't it? That's what I think Shulman is also leading to, right? This can be very easily categorized in a mechanical way. Nowadays, it's very popular because teachers are not doing their job well. They are, what is going on in the world outside? Teacher tests are happening, right? Teacher tests are, they are given paper and pencil tests. Now, please ask the people who create the test, why is this question important for a teacher to answer? I have my doubts, right? I'm being sort of public in this. I'm not sure whether people who create the teacher test know the answer. Why is this item there in the test? They might actually go step by step mechanically by these seven things and put question on each of these. But ask them in depth about it. You know, so it's a sad situation we have got ourselves into teaching, right? We need to understand what is the connection with all these, right? So the second one is general pedagogical knowledge. The third one is knowledge of the curriculum. For example, I often teach science. You should know that at which stage we introduce the word force and at which stage in where all the idea of force is developed up to class 10, what are all the things. So you need to know the whole curriculum. You also need to know sideways, right? And that happened with Shruti. She discovered that when they are measuring volume, it is happening in math class. It is also happening in the science class. So you should see the connection. And then you have the collegiality so that we both teach the same thing at the same topic, right? That is professionalism. You not only are you stuck with your textbook, you understand, children need to understand volume. Volume is taught in maths when you are doing centiliter, milliliter, deciliter, and they are also doing it in science where they are measuring, right? So why not have? And in fact, you can get enough time in the timetable if you combine these two, right? So many things are possible. That's a creative things are possible. So that's understanding the curriculum. In another paper of Shulman, which we will read in this course, he expands on this idea. And this is very specific to Shulman's. He says, जनरल पेडागॉजी, क्लास को कैसे चलाना है, लेसन, हाउ टू स्टार्ट योर लेसन, एंड योर लेसन, हाउ टू डू द इवेल्युएशन, हाउ टू लिसन फ्रॉम द स्टूडेंट्स, ऑल ऑफ दिस इज देयर, दैट इज जनरल, एंड कॉन्टेंट ऑल्सो यू नो. बट ही सेज टीचर्स स्पेशलिटी, एन एक्सपर्ट टीचर्स स्पेशलिटी इज फॉर दिस कॉन्टेंट वॉट इज द मेथड आई विल यूज. इफ आई एम टीचिंग, इट इज नॉट द सेम मेथड. इफ आई एम टीचिंग पोएम अबाउट मैंगो, देन दिस इज वॉट आई विल डू. But if I am teaching grammar today, this is what I will do. If I am teaching a story, this is what I will do. If I am doing a letter writing class, this is what I will do. So you know, you have to know your content, you have to know the curriculum, you have to know your learner, you have to know what is it that you want to get out of it. You bring all of this together. So he calls it specific content knowledge. So if I'm a good maths teacher, I may not be a good history teacher because I don't know history content. I may be really a brilliant maths teacher, but I will probably never be a good history teacher because my content knowledge is not strong. I don't know what is important in history, right? And how to teach it to the children. I have not had the experience of what are the misconceptions they have in history, what are the confusions they have in history. I don't know very strongly why is history there in a school curriculum, right? Of course, most of us think history is a waste subject. That's a different topic. But to understand this, so that is what he meant by pedagogical content knowledge. And the others, knowledge of learners, yeah, CDL kind of thing, but also specific. In this class, right? I'll take some examples, don't get upset. I'm beginning to know that someone will always put up their hand, right? So I know not only the specific, you know, general characteristics of adult learners, but I also know specifically what's going on in your class. And it's like, what, fourth or fifth lesson? But I begin to know, and that's important for me, right? How do I get all of you to pay attention? And I've already told you, general pedagogical skills, I'll keep scanning, right? Nobody sleeps in my class. If they sleep, then I'll do one big dance. Yeah. So, all right. So now what we'll do for the next part of this is that you're already seated in your groups. Now in your groups you will discuss, let me give the instructions clearly, and for the remaining whatever time we have, so you discuss your observation, listen to that and you'll get some time, discuss your observations about teacher and decide on one good teacher, right, just quickly, and then analyze their practice and with the focus on their expertise. All teachers may not show all expertise. Do you understand? So, yeah. So, in your group, discuss and then select one teacher, right? Quickly, you say, this Mahinder Singh, or in X school, I saw this brilliant math lesson. Then you analyze their professionalism with respect to their expertise. Do you get the point? Yeah. Why do you say this? So, suppose you observe that case study Shruti's class, right? Now you agree that it's a good class, not just one class, but you may have your observation, or in your field immersion, or somewhere, or in your own example, Jetha might think of something in Barmer, some good teacher, right? Why is the teacher good in knowledge dimension? We won't go into the other dimensions. So which of the seven categories of the teacher's knowledge base was the teacher's strong point? How did it link to the other categories? Yeah, and then summarize your key points and get ready to share with the class. Maybe 3-4 points you want to share with the class, right? Yeah, you have a question.
I have two questions. Mm-hmm. One is that this whole knowledge based for professional expertise,
yeah,
is it any way hierarchical? Like,
no, it's not hierarchical, except, I mean, you might say that content knowledge and general pedagogical knowledge are below PCK. Yeah. So you're right. Partly hierarchical. So my watch says it's 12:10. So maybe you have only 10-15 minutes. Let's go over a little bit with everybody's permission. 15 minutes. So 10 minutes to discuss and to share. Get started. Don't worry too much.
भी तो 2000 या वहाँ पे सही थे, लाइक दैट वो स्पिरिट ऑफ सेंस पैदा करते थे स्टूडेंट्स में. मीन्स इट्स नॉट अबाउट टीचिंग ओनली, दिस इज द हिस्ट्री यू हैव टू.
Are you, is this group almost done? All right, I think the discussions have kind of just started, but in the interest of time, we will pause it now. I'll hear from one group. It also might give you a sense of, it's kind of difficult to assess, isn't it, what the teachers are doing. And that's also a problem that Shulman is trying to solve, that if we want to capture teacher expertise, if we want to in some ways aid, develop expertise, we need to be able to tell what is it that you want the teachers to do. And he comes across this. The second problem is, how do we test this, right? I'm not necessarily meaning paper pencil tests, but how do we test, how do we sort of say that this teacher has a certain level of expertise which now makes me confident that I will trust our country's children with this teacher, right? Never mind, maybe I can hear from one group and then we will keep this going, this discussion. Okay, go ahead.
I shared with my group my experience of immersion in Almora. I visited 3 days in one school.
I would request everybody to listen. Continue. Yeah.
And the school have 5 classes, 1 to 5.
Uh-huh.
And there is only one ma'am.
Okay.
Okay. Single teacher school that was. And I felt that her expertise like managing the 5 class and putting the good general pedagogical knowledge, pedagogical content knowledge, and knowing his learner, which background they are coming, and giving the proper knowledge by managing the class, like she prepare in home, because she have lots of work in official work like midday meal and other thing to manage. And so she prepare in home to make TLM, teaching learning material, for different classes, and also some videos classes to engage like 4-5 class, the mature class. So they make video learning for in home and then present in class and engage other 3 class with herself. And when I try to take 1-2 classes also there, and I felt that they have proper knowledge of all subject of children. Children are getting knowledge. So I think she was very expertise, and I can call him the professionalism teacher.
You could. Anybody wants to ask a question to understand better about this teacher? Yeah, go ahead.
How she used to manage all the classes and the timings and the content of curriculum?
She make TLC, teaching learning TLM. Material, TLM, in home, okay. And they came, she came, and then firstly, and I also appreciate, she buy one projector and laptop by personal money. Not that was government school, so government not giving the like much support. Since she bought one projector and put the in one class 4 or 5, and giving the like she firstly see the subject of knowledge, and she find the common things which 4 or 5 can should learn. So then she present in class and manage like that.
But still, being a single teacher in a school of 5 classes, even if she engages 4th and 5th using the projector, she does videos and all, and she engages them for 1 period or 2 periods or whatever. How does she manage all sections, all 5 classes?
So 1, 2, 3 classes, suppose that one classes have to learn the alphabet. Okay, so she takes some game type material and find one good student from that one classes and see guide to him to take the classes by using this material.
So, I mean, if we, you can discuss with more, and I think we will revisit it in the next class, but definitely she has learner knowledge and curriculum knowledge. She knows that, you know, what they should be doing. She also is aware that children can self-learn, right? I am very interested. So, you are saying that children made videos and shared with each other in class. वो बच्चे ने वीडियो बनाया
नहीं टीचर मेक वीडियोस
एंड देन या आई मीन सो इट वुड बी इंटरेस्टिंग टू सी व्हाट काइंड ऑफ वीडियोस राइट सो शी इज सॉर्ट ऑफ इन फैक्ट देयर इज अ न्यू टर्म व्हिच इज एडेड टू पीसीके पेडागॉजिकल कंटेंट नॉलेज नाउडे व्हिच इज कॉल्ड टीपीसीके Technological pedagogical content knowledge. This one is already displaying that you can use technology in this situation to, you know, support learning, and it need not be, you know, she's managing. I think there are many excellent things that one would like to do. Maybe you should write this up as a case study. One of the things that Shulman says is case knowledge, like doctors and lawyers have case knowledge, right? He says that in teaching we don't have enough case knowledge. The work of an expert teacher finishes with that teacher's classroom. It's not discussed outside. It's not brought into the, you know, professional discourse. This is one individual teacher. So that's why I was so excited to share Joita's case study. She wrote that case up, this case. So we need a lot of such cases. And if you read even Socket, I think Socket comes from the same institution, I'm not sure. But the paper that we discussed, professional and professionalism, Socket also begins with a case, those three teachers, right? So when you have case knowledge, you can pull out your theoretical concepts better, right? And so we need these cases to also be developed. Let us see. I'm getting an idea. Then I'm sure all of you have developed this. Maybe we should have 7 case studies emerging from this class at the end of it. But that's a thought. With that, we will close the class today. Thank you. I quite enjoyed the class and the discussion.
So, welcome to this conversation. It was a very interesting class, lot of participation from you in the class. Let's start talking about some basic learnings from the class. What did you learn from today's class?
Today's class was on professionalism and professionalization. So there are many terms and many subjects in professionalization, but if you talk about learning from this class, that before I thought that what do we mean by professionalism and professional? So if teacher is a profession and teacher is a professional teacher, so I thought why not tuition teacher can be called as professional teacher? Means in society, while we are roaming, we said someone, he's a teacher. But if he is a tuition teacher, we don't call him as a only teacher. We say him, he's a tuition teacher. So today we understand that if the intensive gives to the teacher, government teacher or someone, we found that there is increase in his effort to teach and learning outcome are become better.
Trained
teachers. So it is clearly distinguished between trained teacher and the tuition teacher. In my opinion, tuition teacher is limited to subjective knowledge only. And trained teacher comes from the D.Ed., B.Ed. who. So he's not limited, he tries to reach the goal of education, aims of education.
But we did not really go into tuition teachers.
But what you seem to suggest that this is one example where you could distinguish between professional and
Means in tuition classes we found that he's giving only subjective. It's math, it's science. So it's maybe a student become mimetic or something. But he's getting only subjective teacher. Okay. But in school, with that subject, teacher have to give responsibilities. Right. Attentiveness, look at the background of the students.
Right. Any other insights that you can share from the class?
So, before coming to this lecture, the preceding lecture actually had started discussing about profession and professionals and so on. And we had a related reading. So, after reading that, I was still a little confused because I would consider teachers as professionals, but there was no distinction between professionals and why do we call them professionals and what is the difference between professionalism and professionalization, which for me was clarified in this lecture because I understood the like one very clear distinction and apart from that, I sort of disagree with what he's saying about the tuition teachers bit, but yeah, for me the lecture was pretty productive and there are a few doubts, obviously, but the basic thing that I really wanted to understand was the distinction between the two words, right. And I did. Right. So that was what I got from the lecture.
Yeah, basically, I also agree with you because I had this sense of confusion in terms of when we assign dignity to a profession, and does this part of dignity will come under professionalism or will come under professionalization? Because dignity is something which you attach to your profession or occupation or anything you do. So I was like, I still have some confusion. Where should we put dignity? Like, where should dignity fall in terms of professionalism or in professionalization? And also, basically so much conflict when we talk about teacher as a profession because people associate the meaning of professionalization when we say teacher as profession because they tend to believe when we were discussing about the term profession as in negative connotations when we were talking about if we associate some occupation with the sense of professionalism it connects with the attribute of being money-minded, that you are associating money-centeredness with that occupation. So yeah, I still have some conflicts whether we should call teaching as profession or not.
Yeah. That is still there, but having that distinct understanding of what we aim to sort of understand was why there's a difference between professionalism and professionalization. That was made pretty clear.
So, to some extent, you're saying there is a clarity on certain conceptual understanding and some more understanding you're going to seek in the further classes, say, for example, she's referring
the
to.
The other thing she said when she clarified the difference was very insightful for me was the types of knowledge.
Right.
And then when we actually went into those content knowledge and the pedagogic knowledge and the skills and the kind of like what strategy to use for what kind of content, then she also brought us to a realization that it is not easy to capture everything right. in just categories.
Correct.
So we went into some we started in some elementary differentiation between professionalism and professionalization yeah. kind of a discussion. But then we went into a really nuanced domain where right. she took us through some of the like readings of Shulman and all of that. And that I think we have just started scratching the yeah, surface, yeah. but it's a very interesting yeah,
that
thing
itself
that we did.
Probably illustrates the complexity involved in teaching. Thank you for bringing out that point. Coming to some of your beliefs, refer to having changed some of her understanding. Could you give some examples of some beliefs that you, some assumptions that you brought to the class, which have been challenged now in the class, and probably you started examining them with a closer scrutiny. Could you think of?
So I did have a kind of a negative preconceived notion about most
mass teacher education programs that they do not really add any value, it seems. So I was kind of buying into this general notion of what the popular notion is that doesn't matter. What difference does the training make? And I think in that I was getting kind of carried away by the quantitative aspects of all these large scale studies that our government education departments do. And that case study that she brought in, that it was a survey that was done between trained and non-trained teachers, a large-scale survey, and when actually incentives were applied, the trained teachers did show improvement. So and that was a very, better, very insightful, yeah. So it was a very, very insightful example, and it broke my assumption. Like, I immediately started questioning within my head, like, what was I believing, and that's not true. It's just that there is something in the environment. I mean, we need to dig deeper. We haven't done enough of digging in the lecture, but there's something in the environment of that teacher's like work environment that is not motivating them enough, which is why the positive aspects of or whatever training has imparted them is not coming out. But then there is scope for that to come out. So there is value in that training. That was a myth busted for me.
Okay. You want to add some points?
Yeah, just it was a very informal discussion between me and ma'am. But I discussed with her about two very drastic examples of teachers. One who would go out, she mentioned in the lecture, also, one who would literally go out of his way to make sure that the students were getting what they deserved and like in terms of every facility that they could get. And there were a group of teachers who did basically nothing. They would just come to the school and for attendance and for their salary and so on. In that discussion itself, she mentioned this study. And I agree with Ruta on having this notion of, okay, B.Ed or a teacher training course doesn't really make that much of a difference, because if you have a good knowledge and you like teaching and something like that, it might be enough.
Right.
But after this example, in that discussion itself, when I had it out of class, she mentioned the study. So right after that, I looked into it. And when it was discussed again, that idea was really challenged, because if a study on such a large scale is done, and it shows that people who have that training are showing more improvements, then there is something to it.
And it also connects with the case study of Shruti, which we had in last class. So we were discussing about how she felt the need of professional degree or training to in order to better her classes, classroom practices, basically. So
we talk a little bit about another significant part of the class is about your participation. How do you organize yourself into small groups? How do you work in small groups? How do you discuss? What are your experiences of working in small groups? Could you share some of those thoughts?
So for the questioning bit, I think for me it comes from all that I know and all that I get to know in the lecture, and when there is a conflict between those two.
So you bring some amount of understanding to the class, and there is some part of it is being challenged in the class,
yes,
both.
Yes. So, and then obviously I have to clarify why there's a conflict in my head and in what is going on in the classroom.
Right.
And so usually there are a lot of times when we discuss in class.
Right.
After a certain topic is introduced or there are some things that are told to us and so on, then we discuss to know what we think as students here.
Right.
And usually, so the groups are always different, first of all, because I think ma'am ensures that it's not the same group of people sitting together. Right. So she has her tricks of giving color codes and sit in this color. So she loves the rainbow, so she gives these seven colors and makes seven groups out of that. And so in that sense also, I think I am a lot more active in her lecture as compared to a few other lectures, because as she also mentioned that I keep looking at you, you should not be sleeping in the class and all. That also makes us conscious.
Yeah.
If we are dozing off, she'll know. And so I think all of that contributes to our activity in the classroom in every way, questioning, discussing and being active in discussion, because there are times when we're made into groups in other places also, and then we see that, okay, it's a group of five and only two are talking.
Right.
But in this... so far, we've had, in this semester itself, we've had like three group discussions, two or three. And in them, I've seen that most people tend to participate. Right. It's very engaging in that sense. Right.
So, you value your participation in the group discussion itself?
Yes, yes.
Often the group discussions are in the class happening, but group discussion is not about our own feelings, not limited to own feelings. Yes. And we discuss in the group discussion about from our own experiences as well as the readings.
Right.
And after such group discussion, practice of such group discussions, we came to know that respecting others' views is
within
also very
groups.
Important, because today in my group, I have also the good example of teacher, Vrushabh also have. But Gyan gives example of the teacher who is managing five
multi-grade setting
classes. So that's the dedication shows in his example, not that knowledge base.
So in your group, now each one of you had examples of teachers, but how did you identify one which is to be shared with the class?
But appropriate was Vrushabh's example.
Right.
But we have to respect Gyan's example also, that he wants that to
be highlighted,
show and show to the class that how with the problem how she is doing.
So that way, that complexity of the problem is much more there in that example. So you decided.
So you decide that you take your example.
Anything else that you wanted to add on your working in small groups?
So, group activities also like always very good when you want rich discussion happen in the class. One thing which is very significant when we are learning in these kind of settings, and when we are learning such kind of when we are having such kind of classroom practices, it also gives us a better sense of pedagogy.
Right.
So we not only learn content, we also learn pedagogy of the teacher.
Right.
So what kind of activities we have in our class, and last class we have a mini survey kind of thing. So it's not limited to the classroom boundary. It also helps us to go out and see how the world thinks about those concepts which you are actually looking for. And when you have to look, when you have to have general view, so you have to go out. So all these things helping us to get a sense of pedagogy also, ki how if we are aspiring to be a teacher, how will it help us to be to engage?
That's a very important question that we discuss in some time. But what I wanted to focus is, say, how this working in small group is significantly different from, say, interacting with one teacher. Now, so many of you asking questions and teacher responding to your question. There is clarity seeking activities happening, but in a smaller group the dynamic is quite different. Could you talk how these two are different and how do these two add value to your learning?
I think what I've seen is when any new topic is discussed or introduced, and usually the discussions happen where they encourage us, our teachers, to dig deeper into it.
Right.
And also try to relate with your own experiences. Like everybody brings their experiences of what they have. Some people have actually been through teaching. Some people have been observing. And everybody has observed a variety of settings. So one of the great things that happens is I get to hear about a teacher in Haryana, about a teacher in Tamil Nadu, about a teacher in some remote northeast tribal school, which I myself will never be able to go reach and take this variety of experiences.
Right.
So that's a very good thing that happens. And then a lot of times we help each other clarify something that not everybody has understood what the point teacher was telling. So there's a lot of peer learning also that happens.
Mm-hmm.
And it has become like almost a natural process for us. Like we do not identify that, we had peer learning, or we had experience sharing or something. So we kind of tend to arrive at our own sort of collective understanding through this.
So put your word in some other way. So sometimes whatever you have not got clarified in the larger group discussion get clarified in smaller group discussion.
Mm-hmm.
yeah. and that happens yeah. through your own mutual interaction.
Yeah, sometimes we also get questions like nobody yes. has understood this clearly, yes. so let's maybe go back right. and ask her to elaborate more sometimes.
True, I mean in today's class a lot of times that happened and you had a lot of questions, but it's also time constraint is also another factor yeah. sometimes that gets into a small group discussion would cater to that much more.
And also one point to be added is that so many people are not able to directly ask the question right. to the teacher.
Right.
So when we sit in groups and when we talk, so right. they also get a chance right. to discuss their point right. of views right. and their ideas.
Right.
Hmm.
Yeah. So another topic that I want to talk to you is about the pedagogy that you already mentioned. Could you talk about the pedagogy that was used in today's class? What did you like about today's class in terms of pedagogical practice? Say there were multiple things, say slides were used, you engaged with your teacher in question answer, you engaged with small group discussion. Consciously, do you look at various factors as she has already mentioned about that. What are your thoughts about it?
Yeah, one thing that fascinates me about her teaching is that she never misses to establish a continuity between the classes.
Yeah.
She'll always connect with what we have discussed and then where we are going. So we have a very clear sense of direction.
That was substantial amount of today's class
yeah.
Involved.
And I think that's a very hard thing to
learning
do.
Learning from previous class.
That's a very hard thing to do. And the other is sometimes people tend to go in different directions. So
right.
we are learning. So we are not always on the spot when she asks questions
right.
and she's seeking to get some relevant answers. Sometimes we say something that is not very, very relevant.
Right.
But then she has the skill to make something out of it that would still be relevant to what we are discussing. So she'll
right.
say, okay, you made this point, but then what we can take from it, it's something else which is relevant for today's discussion, which I think is very fascinating. So she never gets irritated with any single answer, but tries to make some meaning out of it that will be valuable to the class. I think that is very fascinating.
And it doesn't mean that she left that irrelevant question. She
yeah.
keep it with her, and
yeah.
after the main discussion, she goes on that question and explain what that means to the students.
So, seeing classes in the subsequent weeks, for example, how do you think this course is going to take shape? How is the course shaping up for a larger understanding of teacher as a professional? Now, you learned about expertise in what teacher need to know about. How do you see this continuing in subsequent classes?
Nowadays we are discussing teaching as a profession and teaching basically
right.
what teaching is, what the paradigm of teaching entails us. So going like further, we will learn about how teacher, what teacher is, and how, what are the responsibilities and roles attached to the identity of a teacher.
Right.
So I see that this course will give us a better understanding of what teacher is and how that particular person is shaping the experience of teaching for the life of a student.
Yeah.
So how both the things are very complementary to each other.
Right.
Yeah.
So one last question: what kind of preparation you come with to the class?
Honestly, so to come to any of these lectures, we need to have a little bit of knowledge about the discussion that is going on, which
right.
is provided through the material. So
yeah.
that I think is really important, because it really gives you, so it doesn't just give you like an understanding of the lecture, but also gives you an insight.
Yeah.
You question, okay, why did I get this wrong? Why did this not come to me before? Why did, yeah, so all of that happens throughout the lecture itself.
Yeah, and it also helps us to internalize whatever the concepts we are learning, because pre-reading and post-reading with the class discussion, it makes it very enriching.
With that
insight we wind up this conversation. Thank you so much for being here.